Hello everyone in the Ansari. As you all know that we have just concluded the chapter of Indian Parliament and we were discussing about the various provisions. We have taken this chapter in detailed version so as to ensure that if any question appears in the prelims exam or in the mains exam, we'll be able to deal with that. Though we are not claiming that we have gained the expertise of the Parliament, but still we are trying our best to do the best in the exam. So yesterday we were talking about these questions of the mains about Indian Parliament. We talked in detail what kind of parliament we have, what it does, what are the functions, legislative functions, executive functions, judicial functions, and the administrative functions also. Then we were talking about that relevance of Rajya Sabha as a second chamber in the federal setup of Indian parliamentary system. So we were studying and we were talking that how the Rajya Sabha is equal and unequal and has special powers in the parliamentary system. So if we compare and contrast the position of Rajya Sabha, so Rajya Sabha, number one, is having equal power in some matters with the Lok Sabha. Second, it is having unequal powers. And third, it is having special powers. But the question is asking how it is having relevance in the second chamber of the federal. So number one, federal provisions हमें तब पता रखते हैं when the Rajya Sabha can create a new All India service under Article 112. तो ये power सिर्फ और सिर्फ Rajya Sabha के पास होती है. So this is how the federal aspects, because the All India service is assisted and is being assisted for the Union government, for the state governments. As you know that IAS and IPS officers, they are allowed to serve both the respective governments in the cadre form of policy we have. Number two, all the bills which are passed by the Lok Sabha, even it is a constitutional amendment bill, even it is a money bill, there is every bill which is duly sent to the Rajya Sabha for their consideration, and the Rajya Sabha welcomes all kind of bills. Though we have provisions over the money bill that the minimum power the Rajya Sabha exercises over the money bill, but in other cases of bills, for an example, we have ordinary bill, so it acts as a check, it acts as a chamber of checks and balance which scrutinizes the bills framed by the Lok Sabha in the detailed version and with the expertise of the other people who are also nominated by the President of India. Apart from that, it is also having the federal powers, for an example, in the role of the President, in the UPSC, Supreme Court judges, removal and the appointment process. It is also having stake there in studying the reports of the various federal bodies, for an example, UPSC, Finance Commissions, other constitutional bodies like National Commissions on Backward Class, Women, Children, OBC, SCST, and so on and so forth. Then how it is also connected with the federal setup is that we have two agencies, that is the Supreme Court and the UPSC. So Rajya Sabha, along with the Lok Sabha, enlarges the jurisdiction. So that is why it is also having the federal connection with it. Then what are the special powers? If a question comes, like what are the special powers? So number one, if the Rajya Sabha will say to the Lok Sabha and to the whole parliament to make a bill or to make a law on the state list, so it can only be done when the permission is granted by the Rajya Sabha under Article 249. So here the Lok Sabha is somewhat having a limited jurisdiction if we compare it with the Rajya Sabha. Number two, All India Services, we have talked under Article 312. Sorry for the miss of tongue. It is 312, not 112. Then it alone can initiate the removal of the Vice President. Though the time of appointment, both the houses give their due vote to the person to get the vice president, but at the time of removal process, only the Rajya Sabha can do so with a special majority under Article 67. Then, when the Lok Sabha is not already there, when it is dissolved because of any sort of reasons, any sort of exigencies, then it is the Rajya Sabha only which assigns the president to pass the ordinance. So, in the meantime, the passing authority lies with the Rajya Sabha, and if it is approved, then the emergencies can also be laid out with the approval of the Rajya Sabha. Like 352, we have national emergency, 356, we have president rule, and 360, we have the financial powers. So this is how we can say that it promotes the federal equilibrium. If we have to write this term, so we can use this term, federal equilibrium, because in the Rajya Sabha, the representation is the states and the states ensured that the people, the constituency's representatives functions in a democratic and in a people-centric manner. Then, in what ways is the Rajya Sabha expected to play a special role in today's changing political scenario? Again, we have to say this, कि जो चेक्स एंड बैलेंस का मैकेनिज्म है राज्यसभा का, वो अच्छे से उनको निभाना चाहिए. देन डिसरप्शन कम होने चाहिए, एंड लोकसभा में जितने डिसरप्शन होते हैं उससे कम राज्यसभा में होने चाहिए. एडजमेंट मोशन जितने वहां पर पास होते हैं उतने राज्यसभा में कम पास होने चाहिए, बिकॉज इट इज कंसिडर्ड दैट राज्यसभा इज नॉट ओनली द सेकेंड हाउस. राज्यसभा इज कंसिडर्ड एज द सेकेंड हाउस बिकॉज फर्स्ट इट इज नॉट सब्जेक्टेड टू रिजोल्यूशन. नंबर टू, इट इज हैविंग द रिप्रेजेंटेटिव ऑफ द स्टेट एज ए लार्ज. नंबर थ्री, इट हैज एक्सपर्ट्स पीपल. फॉर एन एग्जाम्पल, 12 पीपल हु आर नॉमिनेटेड बाय द प्रेजिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ स्पेशल एक्सपर्टीज. सो इट इज एक्सपेक्टेड फ्रॉम द राज्यसभा दैट यू आर द डिजर्टेड पार्लियामेंटेरियंस एंड यू शुड हैव इम्पोर्टेंट रोल सो एज टू इंश्योर द पार्लियामेंट रन इन अ स्मूथ ट्रांजिशन एंड डेमोक्रेटिक मैनर. देन डिस्कस द मैथड ऑफ डी लिमिटिंग कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंसीज फॉर पार्लियामेंट्री इलेक्शन इन इंडिया, जिसमें हमने बात की दैट Till now we have, I think, 4 delimitation commissions started from 52, 62, 72, 2002, I think, the last one. Delimitation commission hota hai that is appointed by the Parliament of India. Delimitation commission ke andar jo head of the commission hote hai, they are the retired justice of the Supreme or the High Court. Prominent case we have Justice Ranjana Desai Delimitation Commission, which did the delimitation of the various constituencies in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, or we can say currently the UT of Jammu and Kashmir post the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A. Then delimitation commissions recommendations are binding; they are not subjected to the judicial review also, provided there is very strong malafide which is found and alleged on the commission. Then the delimitation commission sets the territorial zenith of various constituencies from where the parliament will get contest and they will come into the parliament to represent that particular constituency. Now, why the delimitation commissions are established? It is only because of the changing demographic dividend, we can say, because of the changing demography across various geographies in India. That is why, to ensure that representation do takes place and the democracy do upholds, that is why the delimitation commissions are established on the timely basis post the census. And currently we have, I think, 87th Constitutional Amendment Act, which bars till 2030 the census that we have to work. We have to run the parliament on the basis of 2011 census, on the basis of the delimitation commission that was, I think, last in 2002. So anyone can rectify me also if I'm speaking a little wrong. Then, what are the grounds of disqualifications of a member of parliament from either house? Quote the relevant provisions in your answers. So we talked that what kind of various disqualification measures we have. For an example, we studied that disqualification can happen in three areas. Number one, where the constitution prescribes a disqualification. What kind of areas constitution prescribes? Constitution says following areas. For an example, if any parliamentarian is having office of profit, then he is disqualified. Number two, unsound mind, undischarged solvent. And the last thing constitution says that he is not a citizen of India and found malafide citizenship. So these are the provisions of the disqualification which are mentioned itself in the constitution. Then constitution in the last laid out that in the future, the parliamentarians will also be subject to disqualification on the basis of law which is duly created by the Parliament of India. So what we have the RP Act 1950, but the RP Act 1950 was not enough to have disqualification and disqualification matters, and so we adopted 1951 Act, that is RPA 1951. It says ki agar koi parliamentarian hai, that is found in the election offences, guilty hai, करप्ट प्रैक्टिसेस करता है, टाइम पर एफिडेविट नहीं जमा करता है, एनमिटी बढ़वाता है लोगों के बीच में, अपने अकाउंट की गलत इंफॉर्मेशन देता है, किसी गवर्नमेंट के कॉन्ट्रैक्ट का भागीदार होता है, किसी ऑफिस में डायरेक्टर होता है या डायरेक्टर से ऊपर एमडी सीईओ की पोस्ट पकड़े हुए हैं, या फिर ब्राइबरी या इसके चार्ज में पकड़ा गया हुआ है, सोसाइटी के अंदर वुमेन को डिरोगेटरी बोल चुका है, उसके बाद अनटचेबिलिटी को प्रमोट करता है, डाउरी और सती जैसी जो एंटी सोशल प्रैक्टिसेज है उनको बढ़ावा देता है, या फिर 2 साल से ज्यादा के लिए डिटेंट हो गया है, जेल में बंद था, इन सारी चीजों के ऊपर जो डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन की बात करता है, दैट इज आरपीए 1951. सो दिस इज द सेकंड मैकेनिज्म टू डिस्क्वालीफाई अ मेंबर ऑफ पार्लियामेंट ऑफ आइदर हाउसेस, दैट इज द राज्यसभा एंड द लोकसभा. Now, what are the third area where the disqualification can happen? That is on the ground of defection, which is mentioned by the 1951 51st Constitutional Amendment Act laid out by the Rajiv Gandhi Prime Minister, sir. In the Constitution, in the 10th schedule, which says कि अगर कोई पॉलिटिकल पार्टी का एमपी किसी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी से हाउस के अंदर आए लेकिन आने के बाद उसको दगा दे दे तो उसको डिस्क्वालीफाई करेंगे. अगर वो अपने पॉलिटिकल पार्टी के जो व्हिप है उसकी बात नहीं मानेगा, 60 दिन से ज्यादा एब्सेंट रहेगा बिना परमिशन के, तो वो डिस्क्वालीफाई हो जाता है. अगर कोई इंडिपेंडेंटली इलेक्टेड मेंबर आया है अपने गुब्बारे साइकिल वॉशिंग मशीन ऐसे इंडिपेंडेंट अपना इलेक्शन कमीशन से टैग लेकर के और वो इलेक्ट होकर आया है, तो वो बाद में ये नहीं कह सकता कि आई लव दिस पार्टी, आई लाइक दिस पार्टी. यू कांट ज्वाइन दैट पार्टी एट दैट मोमेंट व्हेन यू हैव कम इनटू द पार्लियामेंट ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ योर इंडिपेंडेंट टैग. एंड देन द नॉमिनेटेड मेंबर इफ इट इज ज्वाइनिंग द पार्टी एनी पोलिटिकल पार्टी पोस्ट 6 मंथ्स पीरियड, देन ही इज आल्सो सब्जेक्ट टू द डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन. हमने बात की कि अलग अलग जो डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन के प्रोविजन है, हु इज द सोल नोडल अथॉरिटी ओवर दैट. सो एक्सेप्ट द एंटी शेड्यूल एक्ट where the nodal is chairman in the Rajya Sabha and speaker in the Lok Sabha, apart from all these disqualifications, both in the RPN 1951 and both in the constitution provisions, the nodal is the president, who obviously will take the guide and advice of the council of minister along with the election commission of India and along with the speaker and the chairman too. And we also noted that in the IR for Hello case 1920 and 1991, post that we have the judicial review also on both the president as well as the speaker and the chairman in the case they are doing the disqualification and they are sitting as a quasi judicial body. Now, relevant provisions in your answers, we have talked RPN 1951, 10th schedule hai hamare yahan pe constitution ke provisions hai disqualification ke, and office of profit bhi hai jisko article 105 ke andar mention kiya gaya. Obviously that is not defined as such. The next question we have, which of the cases regarding the disqualification for membership of either house are decided by the president? Yeah, maine abhi abhi dekha hai. Then explain the following terms. So here it is mentioned dissolution of the house. So dissolution simply means then when the life of the Lok Sabha is ended by the president, so then the dissolution takes place. The dissolution kai tarike se ho sakta hai. When the motion of thanks is not passed, when the no confidence motion is passed, when the adjournment motion is passed, when the censure motion is passed, when any ordinary bill, when the money bill, when the constitutional amendment bill is not passed, and when the censure motion is passed and there is no confidence motion is passed, which simply means the current government, which is having the majority, has lost their majority on the floor of the house. And even in the case of loss of the majority, the president do provide 1 month time period within which the president, the council of minister headed by the PM needs to and must have to prove their majority on the floor of the Lok Sabha. In case they are not able to do so, then the house is duly dissolved. Prorogation simply means when the subject matter of a particular session is completed, concluded, and about to reach its conclusion, then the speaker and the chairman, both respective officers of the houses, such as the President of India, also the Council of Ministers and the PM, to prorogate the houses. And obviously, in the prorogation, the house is not dissolved, but the house session is dissolved. We can say that session is ended and the next session will happen when the PM, led by the Council, will aid and advise the President under Article 75 to again have the session. Adjournment of the business of the house. Here we talked that adjournment simply means when you are terminating the sitting of a session of a house and it is subjected to both the houses, both in the Rajya Sabha, both in the Lok Sabha, and adjournment where the officer of the house is taking the leave of the house by telling that for particular time period I am going out and I will not conduct. It can be done on various reasons. Number one, when there is no quorum, when there is no 1/10 minimum member available in the house to discuss the matter. Number two, there is a high disruption. Number three, there is an allegation, there is a hue and cry have been there in the houses, then it can be done so. Adjournments and die when all such kind of conditions are available there, but the officer of the house is sitting and going without naming a day to reconstitute the sitting. That is simply the adjournment and die. Now, what is the maximum gap between two sessions of the Indian Parliament? We talked that there is a maximum gap limit, that is 6 months, within which the session should be reconstituted. And we have this parliamentary norm in the constitution that in a year there must be two sessions at least in a year of the Indian parliament. So this is what this question is talking about. What is meant by lame duck session of the legislature? So lame duck session is mostly associated with the Lok Sabha, where the current government is not able to re-back their positions, their majority in the Lok Sabha, and then they come in the opposition way. So when they come in the opposition way, so it is a tag which is associated with the defeated government that they are lame duck. They are not able to come back into the majority seats, and they will not sit on the treasury seats of the Indian parliament. The treasury seats are the seats which are held by the government, which is having the majority on the floor of the house, and all these treasury benches are filled by the ministers. Not a a normal MP can sit on the treasury benches. They are only assigned to the ministers, and they are on the right side, and on the left side of the parliament or the house we have the opposition chairs. Now, what is that? When is the device of joint sitting of both the houses of parliament are available? Here we talked that during the ordinary bills, and during the ordinary bills under Article 108, the President of India calls both the houses of the parliament for the joint sitting to resolve the deadlock on the legislative matter. And occasionally, we have seen that joint sitting is win by the Lok Sabha because of the majority of numbers they have. And in the joint sitting, we have the provisions, we have the constitution and norms, where the president, along with the speaker of the Lok Sabha, will be representing the joint sitting. The vice president cannot hold the similar position. And in the case vice president, speaker is not available, then the deputy speaker and the deputy chairman can also be, because they are the members, but vice president is not the member of the Rajya Sabha, though he is the ex officio chairman of the Rajya Sabha. Then Indian constitution has provisions for holding joint sitting, enumerate occasions when this would normally happen, and also the occasion when it cannot, with reasons thereof. So again, यहाँ पे हम देख सकते हैं कि जो ज्वाइंट सिटिंग 108 के अंदर बताई गई है कब होती है, ऑर्डिनरी बिल के ऊपर होती है. एंड ऑर्डिनरी बिल के अंदर भी हमने देखा है कि ऐसे मैटर्स जहां पर जो राज्यसभा है वो पॉकेट में रखे हुए मैटर को वो छोड़ नहीं रही है, 14 दिन से ज्यादा का टाइम हो गया है. उसके बाद अलग अलग स्टेजेस के अंदर जो इशूज है, पार्लियामेंट्री कमेटी है वो ढंग से काम नहीं कर पा रही है, उसके कुछ इशूज है. देन ज्वाइंट सिटिंग का प्रोविजन है, 6 मंथ से ज्यादा टाइम पीरियड हो गया है, बिल को पूरा रिजेक्ट ही करे बैठे हैं, कुछ भी नहीं कर रहे हैं. तो ऐसे मुद्दों पर ज्वाइंट सिटिंग होती है. एंड किन पर नहीं होती है? मनी बिल पर नहीं होती, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल अमेंडमेंट बिल पर नहीं होती. क्यों नहीं होती है? बिकॉज दे आर वी कैन से दैट दे आर सच बिल्स व्हिच हैव द प्रायर कंसिडरेशन ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया, एंड ऑल्सो द राज्यसभा इज हैविंग समवट लिमिटेड पावर एज फार एज द मनी बिल इज कंसर्न. एंड द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल अमेंडमेंट बिल, we can say that though the Rajya Sabha is not having the limited power, but the Rajya Sabha is having equal power, but still the strength of Lok Sabha is higher. So that is why we can say that the joint sitting provisions we have not on these two kind of bills. Now, who presides over the joint sittings? If we have seen who sits, the President of India, the Speaker, and the Deputy Chairman of the Rajya Sabha. But the vice president cannot sit, and the quorum for the joint sitting is also 110. And the joint sitting is governed by the rules and provisions of the Lok Sabha, not of the Rajya Sabha. This is also we having the norm. And all the bills in the joint sitting, they are also passed by the majority. So we have the majoritarian principle in the Indian parliament, even in the joint sitting also. We cannot say that president has come, so let's pass it with a simple majority. No, it cannot be done. Just the majority of the house should be there, and 110 is the quorum. Now we have a question, define money bill and discuss how it is passed in the house. So we have talked that money bill are mentioned under Article 110 in the Indian Constitution, and money bill ka lena dena jo consolidated fund ke andar se paisa uthane se lekar ke paisa dalne tak ka hota hai. Iske baad jo money bill hota hai usko speaker jo hote hain uske rules hote hain, speaker assigns that this is a money bill, And the prior consideration is also required to introduce the money bill. It will be called as government bill, public bill, not a public, not a private bill, and not even a single parliamentarian of a majority party can represent this bill. Only the minister can do so, and that is why it is considered as a government bill. Then money bill is also subjected to various restrictions as far as the Rajya Sabha is concerned, which simply means that only the 14-day time period is allowed to the Rajya Sabha to discuss and debate on the money bill, and also the veto power is also limited as far as the money bill is concerned in the Rajya Sabha, as they can only suggest the recommendations to the Lok Sabha to incorporate in the money bill. And in case it is not done by the Lok Sabha, then also it is duly enacted within the 14 days expiry period that we have in the Indian Constitution. And how it is passed in the Parliament, it is introduced in the Lok Sabha only, not in the Rajya Sabha. It goes to the Rajya Sabha, and Rajya Sabha within the 14 days has to give the assent and the recommendation. In case it is adopted, then it is passed in the original form, change form. And if it is not accepted, then in the original form, it is duly passed. It goes to the President of India's office, and the President must give the assent to the money bill because it is introduced in the Parliament with his prior recommendation. And he can obviously withdraw the bill. Wo mana bhi kar sakte hain, but he cannot return the bill. This is what we have, the provisions as far as the money bill is concerned. Then powers, privileges, immunities of the parliament and its members. Reason for absence of legal codification and how it can be addressed. So as we know that in Indian parliament, we have individual privileges of the house and we have collective privileges of the house. In the individual privileges, we have the freedom of speech and expression of the parliamentarians, where they can enjoy their fundamental right to speech, to text, to communicate, to lay out any behavior, which is subject to the parliamentary rules of both the houses within the premises of the parliamentarian house. And we have a collective responsibility where you cannot publish a report without the permission of the speaker or the chairman. Then 40 दिन से पहले अरेस्ट नहीं हो सकते, 40 दिन के बाद अरेस्ट नहीं हो सकते पार्लियामेंट के. देन आप विटनेस नहीं बन सकते. देन आप किसी इंक्वायरी में जाकर आपको मजबूर नहीं किया जा सकता कि आप आइए, आप वहां पर मद्देनजर आपको देखा गया था. देन आपको रेप्रीमांड नहीं किया जा सकता, आपको इम्प्रीजनमेंट नहीं किया जा सकता. सो दीज आर द कलेक्टिव प्रिविलेजेस वी हैव. नाउ अगर हम बात करें कि पार्लियामेंट्री प्रिविलेजेस MPs ke alawa kin kin ko hai, so we have for the Attorney General, we have for the ministers also. But the parliamentary privileges are not available to the President, though he is the integral part of the Parliament, but still the parliamentary privileges are not available to the President. Why so? Because he should be able to get selected in the Lok Sabha, but he is not a member of Lok Sabha. So the privileges are only assigned to those people who are currently the members of the houses, either the Rajya Sabha or the Lok Sabha. And the parliamentary privileges are mentioned under Article 105. And similarly, in the case of MLAs and MLCs, we have Article 194 in Part 6 of the Indian Constitution, which talks about such kind of privilege. And now, why there is a need for legal codification? Because of various instances of the breach of privileges and the contempt of the House, where we talked about the various names of the parliamentarians like Vivek Debroy, who is coming from the West Bengal constituency. Then Dr. Pravesh Verma, who is coming from the Delhi constituency. And there are other MPs named. Now, what kind of breach of privileges? In the name of their fundamental right, they sometimes go to the extreme commentaries into the parliamentarians, like calling terrorists to any colleague and, you know, saying abusive languages, saying something derogatory to the woman parliamentarian. Even in the case of Rajya Sabha, we have such kind of incidences, and we should not take the name of such parliamentarian because the matter is under the adjudication of the court. Then, apart from that, contempt of the houses, where the current Chief Minister of Punjab was disqualified in the contempt of the house because he came in a drunken mode in the Parliament House when he was a member of Lok Sabha. And similar instances we have over the other, and currently we have 146 around MPs who have been disqualified on the charges of the contempt of the house and the breach of privileges because they are not allowing the parliament to run in a smooth and transient manner, and they are disrupting the proceedings of the house and on the basis of the charges, such kind of allegations have been put on them and they are disqualified. One more reason, the current vice president of India is alleged to have the partisan interest And the speaker also to have partisan interest for the majority government, that is the executive government or the union government which we have, such kind of things are again under the adjudication by various parliamentarian committees and the court. Now, why we do not have the legal codification? Well, this is a matter which the parliamentarians think, and we should subscribe to this point that there should be a legal codification. Even the Supreme Court in various judgments over the course of time has prescribed to the parliament to have the legal codifications, so that the breach of privileges do not take place and the contempt of the house do not take place, and the parliament responsibility is not to be entertained by the judiciary, which the parliamentarians say that this is a judicial activism, but in the reality that is the non-maintenance of the task, non-maintenance of the separation of power which is assigned by the constitution to both the respective agencies, that is the parliament for the lawmaking and judiciary for the adjudication of the law. Then what is the meant by pro tem speaker? So pro tem speaker is that speaker which is temporary in nature, and pro tem speaker responsibilities is to assign the oath and affirmation and the membership of the houses to the new coming parliamentarians. And pro tem speakers, we can say appointment and the selection is done by the President of India, and within the short span of time, that is I think 1 or 2 months, the pro tem speaker gets nullified and stopped, and the new elected speakers come from the post who takes the responsibilities for the conduct of the house and for the maintenance of the decorum of the house, as well as the debate and discussions of the house. What are the main differences between the passage of a constitutional amendment bill and the legislative bill? So in the constitutional amendment bill, we have talked that constitutional amendment bill comes under Article 368, which prescribes the way of three types, where by the simple majority of the parliament, the constitution can be amended, but those are very minimal areas. Then, and they will not be considered as a constitutional amendment bill. They will be simply considered as an addition or subtraction in the constitutional amended provisions. So they are not the part of constitutional amendment bills. We have two categories of bills which are considered as constitutional amendment bill under Article 368, where one, the president, or sorry, where the parliament, both the houses, can introduce such a bill. That bill is related to the important parts of the constitution, but not to the federal aspect. Here, the special majority of both the houses is duly required, and then the bill is duly reaches out to the president's office, then he assigns it or withdraws this. And I think it is a must condition for the president of India to pass the constitutional amendment bill, because again, here, the prior consideration is duly taken by the minister who is going to amend the constitution from the president of India. And the second provision where the constitution do gets amended, that is Article 368 clause 2, where the federal matters comes, where the features of states comes. So here the special majority of both the houses, along with ratification of more than half of the state legislature, is also taken. But again, there is no time frame over the states, which also leads to the pendencies of such kind of bills and the issues between the center and states over various matters. Then apart from that, other legislative bills. So we have ordinary bills and the money bills. Ordinary bill can come in Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, by minister, by private MP, without recommendation of president, can be amended or even rejected by the Rajya Sabha, can be detained by Rajya Sabha for maximum 6 months. And ordinary, joint summit is also allowed here. President assent is only when both the houses have approved. Then if the defeat of Lok Sabha takes place, then the bill becomes nullified, and the president can use various kinds of vetoes over the ordinary bill. If we talk about the money bill, so for the money bill, only the Lok Sabha has the power to introduce the bill with the prior consideration of the president of India, will be considered as a government bill because it is introduced by the minister only on the recommendation of president. Rajya Sabha has limited powers. Within 14 days time period, they have to do anything in that and without rejecting the bill. It requires a certification of the speaker, which is again immune from the judicial review by the Supreme Court. No one can say that who are you who is deciding the money bill as a money bill, but the speaker has a sole and the competent enough power to decide whether a money bill is a money bill or not, and he is a sole competent power of that. Even the President of India cannot deny that you have done something wrong in the case of doing such kind of exercise. Then If the money bill is a constitutional amendment bill is not passed, then it leads to the defeat of the government and also the dissolution of the Lok Sabha in case they are not able to prove their majority within the 1 month time period in the floor of the House of the Lok Sabha, and can be reconsidered by the president also, but cannot, oh, sorry, can be rejected and can be approved, but cannot be sent for reconsideration by the president when we are talking about the money bill. So these are few questions over the parliament chapter. So for today, we are going to wind up here only. And tomorrow onwards, we are going to start the judiciary part, which is considered as the important and the integral pillar of the Indian democracy. Thank you so much, and keep watching, Sarkari.